Hello, I'm happy to be here. So, I'm David. I see my screen and I will talk to you about using pod identity, meaning binding Azure AD manage identity with pods. So, let's get going. Let me try that. Okay, next, first, thanks to the sponsors. We'll not spend too much time on that. Let's go into the agenda. So we'll have before the conclusion. First, a rapid introduction to get back to the issue that we are trying to work around. Then we'll talk about the solution, which is pod identity. And then we'll talk about the preparation to install this solution on an AKS cluster. And then we'll see how it works. Just for those who follow the news on Kubernetes in Azure, there have been some evolution on that. Pod identity is becoming more integrated. We'll see about that. In this presentation, we'll talk about the open source version and have just a few words on the extension. A little word about me. So, as I said, my name is David. I'm still working on, still exploring the platform, which is nice because there are some new stuff. I like automation a lot more than other stuff. You will see about that during the presentation. I'm still learning in the Kubernetes landscape because this is not that easy. And I can imagine with my avatar, I'm a huge Final Fantasy fan. Okay. Let's start with the context, okay? About that. So, to get to know to be able to use a pod identity, we need to understand first the Kubernetes service relation with Azure AD, and we will dive into the how to. But first, we will look at the prerequisites. To give you some context, as I said, usually when we have a legacy application, let's say, we have a front layer which needs to talk to a data layer, and it involves connection string and authentication and the pain of secret rotation. Okay. Fortunately for us, with the cloud, something that I took directly from the documentation, we can use Manage Identity. And with Manage Identity, the front that I represent earlier would use this Manage Identity to access as a source to target Azure service thanks to this Manage Identity without having to manage any credential. So far, so good. I can have less hard-coded secret, which is fine. And if I have less hard-coded secret, I have even less rotation to do and even less surface attacks. So I'm happy about that. But okay, let's focus on how it's working in the Azure landscape. So in the middle, you have this managed identity. It exists as an object in Azure AD, and it is associated to an Azure resource. Okay. Then this identity bound to your Azure resource is then granted a role through the RBAC assignment in Azure to other resources. For example, we could have a managed identity associated to virtual machine granted, let's say, a read access on the Key Vault. With a corresponding access policy if by happenstance you have not migrated to the full RBAC model for Key Vault. Okay. And in this way, under the condition that the code used by the application running on the virtual machine is up to date, you can authenticate with a managed identity without manipulating any secrets. And that's fine. That's what we want to do. There are two flavors on this managed identity. You have the system assign and the user assign. The system assign, as the name implies, is managed completely by the system in Azure. And you can have only one system assign identity per service instance. On the other end, the user assign identity, you can have more than one user assign identity on one instance of your service, but you have to create that beforehand. Both have their plus and their counter, but you can use either one or the other. I spend a little more time on that because we will talk about in a few seconds about Kubernetes and well, Kubernetes in Azure, and we manage both system assigned and user assigned identity. So that's a concept that needs to be clear if we want to be able to use this pod identity feature. Okay, what happened when we manage container? As a summary, you can say that a container is a way to isolate your runtime, and it removes dependencies on the OS layer, which is fine because you don't have to update at the same time both the OS and the runtime inside your container. Okay, but this isolation also means that we have less integration with your cloud layer, and in our case, by default, at least now, a container running in a virtual machine is completely isolated from your machine, and Azure has no idea of what it's doing, and so it cannot benefit from your managed identity. Okay, and that's where the trouble come. No, before going there, there is one exception. If you have if you have the occasion to manipulate Azure Container Instance, you can associate to an Azure Container Instance a managed identity, and then you have one container or group of containers assign an identity in Azure. And in this case, Azure knows perfectly what is inside your container, but this is a managed container, so this is an exception. And even so, if you have tested that, you have maybe tested also to use it inside a virtual network because usually we like to isolate our workload. And if you use a container instance inside a virtual network, managed identity is not possible anymore. Well, for now at least. So we still have this duality between more integration and more integration with the identity and more integration with networking and other segregation stuff, let's say. Okay, so then we have a proposal for a solution which was developed as an open source project, which is called Pod Identity. Okay, this is a specific project dedicated to first Azure Kubernetes Service and potentially, but I didn't test that, Kubernetes running inside Azure, because it means that we are relying on Kubernetes integrated with Azure AD. Okay, I put the two links into the presentation, one for the documentation of the project for Pod Identity, the GitHub repository, I mean, and another one with the documentation, which is a GitHub page, as a matter of fact, detailing the concept of Pod Identity. I still refer to that, even if it is now more exposed inside the Azure documentation. But as for other open source project, progressively adopted by as Nakai said on, the documentation is always more up to date on the open source project. That's perfectly the case for if you have tested that application gateways on Ingress controller. The documentation is not that much up to date on the Azure documentation when you compare that to the open source project. Okay. That being said, if we want to look at what it's doing, well, we are kind of extending the Kubernetes environment. So, as each time that we have to extend the Kubernetes environment, we have what is called the CRD resource, custom resource definition. And we have three. First, Azure Identity, second, Azure Identity Binding, and third, Azure Assigned Identity. Those three CRD will help us to make the correlation between the managed identity inside the Azure control plane and the corresponding object that we want to associate with our pod inside the Kubernetes control plane. Okay, we'll have a little schematic about that afterward. Then we have also two other stuff, a deployment, which is more classic in terms of controller in Kubernetes, which is called MIC for Managed Identity Controller. And we have also a daemon set, which is called Non-Managed Identity, which means that we have an instance of that, as implied the daemon set, on each node. And this daemon set is talking with the MIC to manage the association of identity on your pod depending on where they are running in terms of node. Okay. Let's detail the corresponding of the control plane. So on the left side, you have the Azure control plane with the user assigned identity. And on the right side, you have the Kubernetes control plane, which doesn't know exactly what's going on inside Azure, except in our case that it is integrated in Azure ID for authentication. Okay. So on the left side, you can create a manage identity, user assigned manage identity, and by doing the CRD, you will create a correspondence between your Azure identity in Azure and in your Kubernetes control plane. So first, you will find the Azure identity which match in terms of property the user assigned identity in Azure. Then we will have a binding because everything is volatile in the Kubernetes environment, so we cannot attach directly an Azure identity to a pod. We'll have in-between object, which is the binding, which will find its correspondence thanks to a specific label, the pod ID binding, which will make the correspondence. We'll show that, we'll see that in the demonstration. And this label is obviously declared in the manifest for the pod. And it's by this way that we can have the correspondence between the identity and in Azure and the pod. Okay, so this little schema hopefully helps you to see how it's working, and we will see some detail of configuration afterward. Next, we have the architecture in terms of how the identity are getting associated, and this schema is taken directly from the documentation in the GitHub page of the project. So you can see on the node that we have a node manage identity daemon set over there, which is communicating with the pod. You can also see that this NMI is talking to the Kubernetes API server, obviously, because everything is going through the API server. And then the manage identity controller is also talking to Kubernetes API server to communicate with the NMI, and it's also responsible to interact with the RRM interface to make the correspondence with your identity endpoint. Okay, a little more visual, you have this schema. So if you have a pod that needs to access a service such as Azure Storage or Azure Key Vault or Azure SQL, we have this pod associated with an identity. Okay, so it will request a token from Azure Active Directory from its managed identity. This token will be, if successfully authenticated, it will be issued to the pod, and the pod will be able to authenticate on the service under the condition that this identity has also an RBAC assignment on this service, which is the number four represented over there, stating that we have an assigned permission which allows us to determine if it's allowed or denied. Okay, so first associating an identity, then this identity will be used to get a token under the Azure Active Directory tenant, and then this token will be used to authenticate without any password on the Azure service on which the identity is assigned a role. Okay, pretty fine. Okay, so that's for the theory. About the installation. So as I mentioned, we have a few prerequisites. We need to have a Kubernetes with RBAC, but well, you should not have Kubernetes without RBAC anymore, as a matter of fact. And we also need to have Azure ID integration. That's kind of not that much difficult to do now. If you have managed Kubernetes in the past, well, Azure Kubernetes Service in the past, it was kind of a little more a headache because you had to manage two application registration to do this integration. Now we have This way is called the legacy way, and the new way is called the AD manage integration. And this AD manage integration allows to have something done under the hood by Microsoft, benefiting from the other managed identity that are associated to your Kubernetes cluster. Okay. Here we have some extract. As I mentioned, I'm breathing Terraform, so this is just some sample that I do to show you how I get the identity. But if you use az click command, you will find something similar. You can find in the manifest of your Kubernetes cluster the associated identity, and we have two the what I call in this output the kubectl plan system assigned identity, if you use a system assigned identity, and another one which is called the kubelet user assigned identity, which, as the name implies, is a managed identity used to interact with the kubelet agent working on the node. Okay, so you have two different identities used for your pod identity, the one for the control plan and the one for the worker plan, but doing the interaction with the control plan, which is kubelet. If you remember your Kubernetes architecture well, you have on one way the control plan with all its stuff and the API server. In your case, this is the part that is managed by Microsoft. And we have the worker plan with the nodes. And on this worker plan, we have the main concept, the main building blocks to make it work is kubelet, which is the agent communicating with the API server to receive the instruction from the control plan. Okay, so you can get those identity either through azkli or as I did through Terraform output, if you use Terraform, and using that, as you can see on the print screen, you have client ID and user assigned identity ID, which is the resource ID, and those are property that you need when you're making the correlation with the Kubernetes object that I mentioned earlier. Okay. Next, what do we have? I have an example of the resource deployed, but what I propose you is to check a real life cluster because this is much more fun. So let's switch over there. I should have two deployed environment, one which is deployed in advance because I'm not crazy, and another one that I will deploy with you afterward. So this one is, let me zoom because this is too small for you. This one is an already deployed cluster. So as you can see, this is the cluster called AKS AZD. Okay. And if I check on this cluster, if I want to see the identity associated with my cluster, I need to go into the properties of my cluster over there. Kubernetes, if you are familiar with it, is using a kind of backend resource group, which you can find in the property over there. And if you, as I did, you modify the name, you can find it over there. Okay. So as you can see over there, you can see that we have at least one managed identity, which is the agent pool, and this one is the kubelet identity. Okay, those other one we don't really care, but as the name can imply here, this one is for the Azure policy and this one is for the AMS agent, but that's topic for another day. Okay, the one that you cannot see is the one associated with your Kubernetes cluster. I could use a system assigned identity and then there would be no problem, but that's not what I did, because for other issue I had to manage that with a dedicated managed identity. So this identity is the one associated with my Kubernetes cluster. Okay, and that's an option that you can do when you create your cluster either through azkli or as I did through Terraform, you can declare an already existing user assigned identity and associate it with your cluster. It's not necessary something that you want to do, but if you need to manage private link with your cluster, you need to have an identity which is already able to access to your private DNS zone, and then this identity need to come before the cluster, so you need to use user assigned identity. Again, topic for another day, so let's not focus on that. You have one identity for your control plan and one identity for your one identity for your kubelet agent over there. Okay, just to illustrate what I said in the introduction, if we check the virtual machine scale set, which is the node pool, and if we go in the identity section, you can see that there is no system assigned identity, but there are a bunch of user assigned identity, and this one being the aka SSID agent pool. Okay. Okay, perfect about that. I switch back over there and let's switch back to our slide. So that's just to show you what you should expect on this print screen. You can see that I did some more tests. We will have only one pod associated with an identity today. Okay. Next, we have a few examples on how to be sure that your pod identity system is able to interact with the Azure environment. If I go back into my slide, just remember that over there, we have something like that. Okay, so we have an identity over there which needs to be associated inside your Kubernetes control plane. Okay, so to do that, those identity that I mentioned earlier need to be able to interact with your identity and your node pool. Okay, so that's why here we have an example of a role assignment for your kubelet identity. We have two role assignments which are required, one for the with the virtual machine contributor role to grant the access to this identity so that it can manage the node pool and do stuff under the hood on your node pool. And another one, which is to manage the identity, the manage identity, so the manage identity operator. And depending on where you want to place your manage identity, you need to choose accordingly the scope. So in this case, in this example, you can see that I associated this identity with an RBAC role on the scope at the subscription level, because in my environment, I took the hypothesis that I would have identity somehow everywhere in my subscription. If you want to be more secure, you should target more tightly your RBAC scope for that. Okay, and be sure that the manage identity that should be managed by your pod identity or only in one resource group. Okay. Okay, now we are going to do the installation. If you want to do the installation, you can follow the documentation with the getting started over there. And if you want to do that, I will say the old way. You can use either the YAML manifest. I don't do that anymore, but I'm just showing that to illustrate for one purpose of illustration. Starting from the version 1.7 of pod identity, by default, you cannot activate pod identity on a cluster with kubenet. I learned that the hard way because I do some cluster for some of my clients with kubenet for networking reason, as you probably know, and so I was kind of surprised that it was not working anymore, and then I found that into the documentation. If you want to force the compatibility with kubenet, you need to specify this argument in your container or use it with the Helm chart that you can use to deploy, and I will show you that afterward. Just a last word before going more into the real demo. As I mentioned, now you can use the pod identity as an add-on, an AKS add-on, which means that it's managed by Microsoft, and which means that it's supported by Microsoft also, because Microsoft is responsible for the update of the of the images of your pod, of your NMI and NVIC. Okay. If you want to do that, you can do it that way with AZ-CLI. I guess that once it gets in GA, it will also evolve for those who are doing Terraform, such as me, into your provider. For now, it's only available through AZ-CLI or through the classic N deployment. Okay. Note that even if you are doing that with the AZ-CLI, if you're using Kubernetes, you specify a switch for enable pod identity with Kubernetes. Okay, because it needs to be identified. Why is it not by default enabled on Kubernetes? There is a reason explained on the documentation related to the nature of Kubernetes in as a network provider, but that's also a topic for another day. Okay, so. Let's switch to demonstration environment. Okay. So for this demonstration, we will use this one. Is that this one? No, this is not this one. Sorry about that. It should be this one over there. Not this one. Sorry, I need to find the proper window. This is this one. Okay. I will zoom because if not, you will not be able to see anything. Okay. I will reduce some window over there. Okay, so now that we are here, let's clear the screen and go first into the environment. So here we have the environment that is already deployed. As I mentioned, I deployed that through Terraform. And then we are going to switch to the installation of pod identity. Okay. So as I mentioned, I'm not doing that anymore with the YAML manifest. I could, but I'm becoming lazy. So I have a name release, which is pod identity, which is explained here. And if I'm just doing click init and then plan and then apply, you can see here I have a simple configuration because everything is defined in the M chart. As a matter of fact, this is just a nice way to call that and have it in the same way in your pipeline if you use pipeline. Just to show you one stuff over there, you can see the parameter that are declared over there, and I can show you that this parameter, or if I'm correct over there, not L pod identity, perfect. And as you can see here, I'm specifying the version of my pod identity chart. And here I'm specifying a few parameters. The first one being that I want to allow Kubernetes, as I mentioned. And the second one being that I want to install the custom resource definition. If I don't do that, it won't work. Okay. So let's just do an apply because we're crazy and we don't have that much time anyway. Okay, it will take a few minutes to apply that, and then we will go to the follow-up of the demonstration. So that's the easy part, installing that through an M chart. Once you're ready to install it, it means that you have already done all your preparation and it's okay, it's good to go. Afterward, we will try to make some correlation between our pod identity and our manager identity and our equivalent inside Kubernetes. But first, let's see if we have deployed what we wanted to deploy. So let's move back to the portal because sometimes it's easier to go into the portal. And thankfully, Microsoft has helped us a lot to have some graphical interface. So if I'm going into my Kubernetes cluster, this is another one. As if you are attentive, you may have noticed that this is a different subscription. Okay. On this this cluster, if I'm going into namespace, I should be able to see a namespace pod identity. You can see that it's active since less than 1 minute. This is indeed what I just deployed. And if I'm going into the workload, I should see specifying the appropriate namespace. And I have one deployment pod identity, okay? And no, not replica set, but daemon set in pod identity, okay? This is what I wanted to see. If I'm going back into the command line, let's get the credential for our subscription, but first I need to authenticate that account set. I need to specify my subscription. Over there, if I'm correct, I should have that here. Okay, let's reduce that. Okay. Okay, now let's clear my screen and take more place. Now I want to get the credential. I need to list my cluster. If I don't know which cluster I have, I will not be able to get the credential. This is the initial port. This is just a new cluster, so I need to authenticate on that. Okay, and I guess get credential, allow me to get the credential on my Kubernetes cluster, but I need to specify its name. Group. Should propose me to. Oh. Okay. Obviously, because I did not copy-paste the proper resource group. I have already an object existing because unfortunately I created two clusters with the same name, so I need to overwrite. Yes, I want to overwrite. Okay, it's clear. And now if I'm doing just a kubectl get node just to check the node, it asks me to authenticate somewhere. Okay, because this is, as I mentioned, integrated to Azure AD. So that's the easy part. Okay, it seems to be working and I can see my pod. Okay, so now if I want to check that everything is all right, I should check the log of my deployment. Okay, as I mentioned, I'm lazy, so I prepared beforehand a walkthrough. So once my Kubernetes cluster has its user assigned identity system deployed, I can check the log somehow like that that way. Okay. Okay. There is no big error, so it seems to be all right. Okay. So next step now is to do the association between my managed identity and the CRD inside Kubernetes. I prepared beforehand a template, and this template through my provisioning is populate with the appropriate variable. So you can see here I have a file corresponding to my identity. If I check that into my portal over there, not this one, but this one. I'm checking this identity, the properties, the resource ID seems to be corresponding to my manifest, and I will just check that. I don't want to check everything out. Not this one, this one. Okay, if I'm doing just or not, is it a good one? Doesn't seem to be working. I failed my demonstration. Oh no, this is not a good one. I'll check that. Okay, let's see that. I need to create a bunch of resources, so I will just copy paste my path over there, and then just create your corresponding object. Okay, and then I need to, yes, I was not looking to good identity. I will do the binding. So we have, as I mentioned, we have two objects. Let's do that. I will just re-explain what I just said. Too fast. Okay, remember I mentioned earlier that we have the custom resource definition, the adipole identity, which is the first one, and the binding, which allows us to create an association between an identity and something else afterward. What you cannot see yet is the association with the pod, which is the Azure identity binding, well, representing the already associated identity, but we could check that in the command line afterward, but we won't do that yet. Let's go back to the walkthrough. So where we are, we deploy the pod identity, okay? We could check the log again, why not? So we'll clear screen because this is unreadable. Everything seems okay so far, okay? So let's going to the next step. In our example, we'll deploy, we'll try to illustrate our purpose with a pod accessing a managed identity without, no, accessing a secret inside the key vault without having to use an R-coded identity. For that, I'm using another moving part, which is the CSI secret store. I will not explain too much on that today. Again, we are limited in time, but that is obviously a full topic on its own. Okay. So I'm deploying the prerequisite for the CSI, which is container storage interface in Kubernetes for the secret store. And then I need to deploy the equivalent to have the Kubernetes secret store for Key Vault, so that Kubernetes knows how to identify the equivalence with the Key Vault. Okay, the same as pod identity, this one is becoming more supported, and there is also an add-on which is still in preview. So in the future, we won't do that anymore. Once we have deployed all the prerequisites, we need to create an association with the a key vault inside Kubernetes, and that's what I call here the secret store. So as you can see on this file, this is a secret providers class with the name IKV June 25, and this is corresponding to this specific, not this one, to this specific key vault over there, okay? And inside this key vault, we have a secret, we'll see that afterward. Okay, so let's just take this file and create the equivalence, okay? And then we'll be ready to create the a pod which needs to access this key vault and read a secret inside of it, okay? Okay, so I have created a secret provider in associated to a key vault, and now the last but not least step is to create a demo pod which is associated with a managed identity and then able to mount a CSI. So you can see it's over there. If I zoom in, you can see in the metadata I have one label adipod id binding UI demo binding, which is corresponding to the binding that I deployed earlier, which is the associated to the corresponding user assigned identity, okay? And then I also have a volume which is mounted as a CSI for container secret storage interface, which is corresponding to a secret store with this name, okay? I can specify a bunch of other attributes, but I will not extrapolate on that today. Again, this is another, this is the full topic on its own again. So let's copy paste this, this path and then just apply. That, and I have just a few minutes ready. So let's just verify that it's working nearly fine. Get pod, no, not get pod, describe. And I need to specify the name of my pod. If everything is okay, I should see that it's working. It's pulling the image, there is no error, so it seems to be all right. Doing get pod. Okay, it seems to be already running. So now the last step that I need to do is to connect to this pod and see if I can access my secret. Okay, so do step or explain over there. I just need to do a kubectl exec. You can see that here I have the KVS demo one, and then the second command line that I want to execute is this one, so I can see what is inside my Kubernetes secret, and I can see a version of a secret. Just to be sure to illustrate fully what I wanted to show you, if I'm going into secret, and I'm going over there, clicking on my current version and showing my secret over there, show secret value, and it seems to be all right. Okay, so this is the same. So let's go back to our slide and switch back to everything that I just illustrated. As I mentioned earlier, the last step for the CSI driver is that it will be available as an add-on also, so it will be less complicated in the future, but it will also mask the complexity of how it's working under the hood, which is too bad. And we can go now into the next step before before stopping this session. Okay, so what we have seen here is that we have a way to associate manage identity with pod on inside the Kubernetes cluster. An Azure Kubernetes cluster, which is fine. There is a lot to do before being able to understand how it's working. And I guess that I admit that I'm not still sure that everything is quite clear in my head how it's working under the hood. The important stuff to remember also is that more support is coming. This is still in preview for now, but it will be in GA soon enough. And even when you are able to do that, you will need to understand how it's working with the other moving parts, such as CSI secret store or your application inside Kubernetes, so that they can be associated with the identity. So eventually, a pod running an application with some code will need to have its code updated so that it can work with that. Okay, and I guess I am finished, which is fine because if I'm correct, I should be finished in 3 minutes.